The Rawhide Little Theater Group presents Wuthering Heights, Emily Bronte's powerful story of a strange and savage soul whose love for one woman was exceeded only by his hate for all those who sought to destroy that love. Herewith, Wuthering Heights.
Often in my dreams I go back to Wuthering Heights, to that rambling old home by the moor, where I was housekeeper for so many years. In my dreams I sees again young Cathy Earnshaw, her brother Hindley Earnshaw, and old Joseph the butler. And if I've ate too much beer and chips before going to bed, often in my dreams I see Heathcliff. I shall never forget that stormy night when Heathcliff come to live at Wuthering Heights. We was all sitting in the kitchen, me and old Joseph and the two children, waiting for the heir of the household, Master Earnshaw, to come home from Liverpool. The dogs, what guarded Wuthering Heights, was laying on the kitchen floor. Great big strapping brutes, awful brutes, what would bite your finger off as soon as look at you. And it was awful expensive, as we didn't have socialized medicine in them days. Suddenly, the door flew open, and in come Master Earnshaw with a large bundle in his hands.
Oh, Papa, you've brought us home a hamper of tuck.
No, son, no. I've brought you and your sister Catherine home a little baby brother.
Oh, Papa, I'm so happy for you. Now all your old clothes will fit you again, won't they?
Catherine, dear child, I found the baby abandoned on the moor. Goodness, I must buy these children some guppies. Joseph, give me a hand here, will you? Put the baby down on the floor.
Hey, it's a strapping child. I dare say it weighs 14 stone. Are you sure it bain't a pony?
I wonder who its parents were, poor thing.
Judging by weight, I don't think it were born. It were built by druids.
I say, let's call it Stonehenge, Papa.
None of your nonsense now, Hindley.
But, Papa, it's a dreadful gypsy child. Oh, let's turn the dogs on it for sport, shall we? Won't that be smashing, Catherine?
May I kick it in the head, Papa?
Oh, you nasty, nasty children. Joseph, get that dog away from the baby. I'm going to see fair play here.
Here, Mangler. Here, come. Thou can't bite baby tonight, but if they're a good dog, thou may have him tomorrow. Come, Mangler. Out, thou gang. There thou go.
Joseph, I thought I told you to put that wretched dog outside.
Aye, Master Earnshaw. Strangler bain't making them growls. They be coming from throat of yon baby.
Good heavens.
Aye, he's a wild, dark thing. Mark my words, there'll be no good come of him.
As the years went by, young Heathcliff grew into a strapping young boy. As a matter of fact, they was always strapping him. By the time he was 14, his shoulders were so broad he could scarcely get through the doorway. One day, as he were coming through the doorway with his strapping big shoulders, like every time the same thing happened.
I say, Heathcliff, you might have a little more care, can't you? Can't you come in sideways or something? That's the fourth door frame you've ruined in 3 days.
I don't care. I don't care for nobody nor nothing, see? I'll get even with yous, boy. I'll get even with yous, Hindley.
But Heathcliff, what have I done?
I don't know. I don't know what you've done, but I'll think of something, dear. I'll get even with yous, boy. You see if I don't. I'll get even with you if it's the last thing I ever do, boy. I'll fix you good.
Young Heathcliff, he was always smouldering and resentful-like. His great dark forehead was always clouded over, and his black fierce eyes was always glaring out from underneath. The only one he acted nice with was Miss Cathy Earnshaw. One day, in the yard, as Heathcliff was out in back strangling a litter of pups,
Heathcliff. How do you like to go riding over the moor with me, Heathcliff? I'll lend you my pony.
I'd just like to go riding over a 500-foot cliff there.
Why do you say such dreadful things, Heathcliff?
I'll get even with you, boy. You just see if I don't cap your jaw. I'll get even with you, and I'll fix you good, boy.
About this time, Miss Cathy, who was a fine-looking young miss, began to receive calls from an aristocratic young suitor named Edgar Linton. His family had lots of money, and they lived at Thrushcross Grange, not far from Wuthering Heights. Heathcliff never said much, but I always felt he was a little bit jealous of young Edgar Linton each time Edgar came to call on Miss Cathy. Mind you, a stranger wouldn't notice the jealousy, but it just seemed to make itself known to those what knew Heathcliff. I just seemed to sense that, somehow, Heathcliff didn't quite like Edgar Linton.
My name is Edgar Linton, and I've come to see Catherine. My family has lots of money, and I live at Thrushcross Grange, not far from Wuthering Heights, period.
Bust off, cement head, or I'll slam the door in your hand and make you pick up your own fingers there.
Oh, dear.
I'll get even with you, boy. I'll fix you good.
Oh, Catherine, he broke my hand.
That's lovely. That's engaged. I use bad language there.
Heathcliff, you dreadful beast. Let Edgar in this very minute.
I'll get even with you, Cathy. Boy, you just see if I don't. By golly, I'll fix you good.
Sometimes when young Edgar Linton would pay a visit to Cathy, young Heathcliff would sit with them trying to join in the conversation. He tried awful hard, and if they'd only encouraged the poor boy, more things might have been different. But poor boy, he didn't have much book learning, and it used to be rather sad when Heathcliff sat with the two of them. Edgar, will you have some more tea?
Thank you, Cathy. This is quite adequate, however.
Heathcliff, will you have some more tea?
I was wondering when you was going to ax me. My saucer's empty. Boy, I'll get even with yous, Cathy. I'll fix you good.
Edgar, getting back to our poetry discussion, what do you think of Keats' Endymion?
Oh, it's superb. It's just lovely.
It ain't so hot. If that's the same stuff I used on the old Guernsey bull last week, it don't come nowhere near Glover's mange cure.
Oh, that Heathcliff, Cathy, is so ignorant.
I'll get even with you, boy. You just wait, I'll fix you real good.
It was during one of Edgar Linton's visits that the spineless little monkey got up enough nerve to ask Cathy to marry him. I shall never forget that evening. Edgar and Cathy were sitting together on the divan, and all the time Edgar was proposing to Cathy, Heathcliff was sitting close by, moodily poking at the live coals in the fireplace with his bare foot. Suddenly, when Cathy told Edgar she'd be his wife, a strange thing happened.
Cathy! Cathy! I must go out on the moor again, to the lonely moor and the sky, and all I ax is a sharp stick to poke in Edgar Linton's eye.
All night, Heathcliff stayed out on the moor, dashing about like a crazed animal, running at trees with his head down and knocking them up by the roots. He was never seen at Wuthering Heights again. Meanwhile, Cathy and Edgar was married, and they went to live at Thrushcross Grange. And one day, 6 years later, while Edgar and Cathy was having tea out on the front lawn, who should drive up but...
Hey, Edgar! Edgar Linton! How you's making out with that there Keats and Dominion, Keats and that there poem there?
Edgar, it's Heathcliff. Oh, what a fine-looking chap he is. Lovely clothes and that beautiful car.
Yes, sir, boy. Like I always say there, a thing of beauty is a joy forever, you know. Its loveliness increases there. It will never pass into nothingness, you know, there.
By heavens, Kathy, he's even learned Keats Endymion.
Yes, sir, boy. That's a real gentleman now. Hey, Kathy, don't just sit there. Pour me a saucer of tea, will you? Come on, where's your hospitality there?
Try as she might, Kathy couldn't disguise her delight at having Heathcliff back home again. They began to see more and more of each other, and poor Edgar began to grow jealous. He felt that now he was the one what was left outside of things. Of course, I think it was mostly his imagination, you know.
Boy, Kathy, it sure was swell going on that 80-mile hike across the moor with you there today.
Yes, yes, Heathcliff, we indeed did have fun, didn't we? You know, Heathcliff, we are two wild kindred souls, aren't we?
Kathy, please, can I come in, Kathy? It's raining outside.
Bust off, Bill Bailey, bust off. Kathy and me, it's talking literature there.
Yes, them was happy days indeed for Heathcliff and Kathy. But alas, they wasn't to last for long, for poor Kathy come down with a black death. Night after night she tossed and turned in feverish delirium, and I think it was then that Heathcliff, spending a constant vigil by her side, showed for the first time an almost tender quality in his brute-like nature. Heathcliff, I haven't long to live. Take me in your arms, Heathcliff.
Kathy, you just can't die, I tell you. I won't let you.
Please, Heathcliff, don't shake me. You're shaking the life out of me.
Oh, Kathy, you can't die. Hey, Jalita, Manina, thy tiny head is frozen. Let me clasp it to me heart, Kathy.
Heathcliff, you're crushing my head. I'm dying, Heathcliff.
Heathcliff. Heathcliff, I know I'm being a terrible nuisance, but do you mind if I see my wife before she dies?
Bust off, Edgar Linton, bust off! Kathy, speak to me. You can't do this to me. Speak to me.
Heathcliff, stop shaking me, please. I'm dying. That night, Kathy up and died, and Heathcliff went completely mad with anguish. Out under the moor he went, in the rain and wind, stumbling along like a wild animal.
Kathy! Kathy! You shouldn't have died, Kathy! You shouldn't have done this to me, Kathy! I'll get even with you, Kathy! I'll fix you good! You just see if I don't, I'll write dirty words all over your tombstone here! Kathy! Kathy!
Well, all that was many, many years ago, and as I look back on them tragic, turbulent lives, I'm glad I lived a dull, uneventful one, for at least I have me own home now, and a good husband to look after me. Ain't that right, dearie?
Yes, sir, boy. Yous ain't as good-looking as old Kathy, but boy, oh boy, can yous cook.